The story of Apep and Atum, the first battle of chaos and order, and the first sibling rivalry in existence. Now, in the earliest of time, there was nothing but the noon, which was a voidless, vibrationless existence. It was considered to be sound without vibration. It was a consciousness with no active thought. It was in a deep sleep that had no dreams. And noon had existed like this for all time, all prehistory. But within noon, there was a desire to create existence. And within noon, there was also the desire to remain the same. And these two sides debated back and forth whether to continue its existence as is or create life and create a cosmos, something that would require work and attention. And finally, deep within the noon, there became a conscious thought. Some would call it an awakening, that this ancient, dormant, docile, sleeping entity had come to life and finally had thought. This was the biggest awakening, and this moment of thought would plant the seed for all other thoughts that would come in history. And after a time, it began to create, and the first being that it created was itself Apep, who is known as the Great Snake, the bringer of chaos and the devourer of worlds. And Apep represented the ultimate chaos. He was indeed the personification of all chaotic existence. The irony in this is that his very existence, that Apep had taken a form, male or female, was antagonistic to what his existence was. Because Apep was tasked with destruction, to tear things apart, to be the opposite of order. And for a time, there was only chaos that existed. And then came a second wave of thought from the Great Noon, the silent vibration, as it was called. And from that vibration, it created Atum, who would later be known as Atem or Amen or many other names. And he would be deified not only as the creator god, but also a god associated with order. And these two, of course, were instantly at odds, feeling that they could not exist in the presence of the other. Apep immediately went on the offensive and wrapped Atum within its coils. But he found that Atum was as much his equal, and that neither could gain the upper hand on either. Now Atum knew its existence, and knew that if it went deeper into the noon, that it would create only more order, and that the delicate balance may in fact be tilted. So Atum created his first children, who were Shu and Tefnut, and he sent them forth into the unknown existence, to find a place where they could exist, to create the life that he had been tasked to bring about. And they searched far and they searched long, and soon Shu and Tefnut were lost. Now in their absence, Atum had grown lonely and he was defenseless without his son and his daughter. And although he lacked a form itself, his essence could create a form, and it created for Atum an eye, and the eye was Atum's ultimate protector from the chaos that Apep represented. But he grew so lonely missing his children that he took his singular eye and sent it forth into the unknown cosmos to find and retrieve his lost children. And the eye was gone, far beyond the perception of even the great Atum Ra. And in its absence, Atum found that it was completely defenseless to the chaos that Apep wielded. And soon the chaos began to cover the god, who was creation himself. He summoned for his own protection another eye, this being of a male gender, as his previous eye had been more of a female gender. And the eye served to protect him, and ultimately, in time, his first eye returned with his children, Tefnut and Shu in tow. And these beings represented both air and moisture, but being that there were no planetary bodies, there was no place for them to work their magic. So again, Atum focused and brought another being into existence. and this being was Thoth, who would be wisdom. Thoth instantly knew what his role was, because he was full of all the wisdom and knowledge in that existence, and he went about his task of building order. And Atum spoke to him and said that you will set forth the rules for this universe, how it will work and how we will regulate. And Thoth gratefully accepted his promotion. Atum then created another being, and this being would be known as Ma'at, and Ma'at personified all the rules and structure that had been put in place or developed by Thoth. And mythologies tell us that those two were consorts, combined. Thoth creating the rules of the universe, and Ma'at being the personification of those rules, holding all things in balance. And it is said to live a good life, one must be in balance with Ma'at. Now Atum created other deities, and soon he created Montu. And Montu was the protector of Ma'at, since she was the representation of the order and balance that Thoth had written for the universe. His task was a great one, to protect her at all costs. And he created other beings, and these would be known as Geb and Nut. Geb representing the earth, and Nut representing the sky. And the two loved each other so much that they were bonded together. But when it was time for creation to exist, and though they had conceived four children, none of them could escape Nut's womb, because she was wrapped so tightly around her brother. So Atum ordered Shu to separate the two, and although Nun resisted him, he was able to easily overpower her. And once he did, there came forth the four children of Geb and Nut, and these would be Nephthys, Oset, Asar, and Set. And these would be the children of Atum. Now Atum created for himself a physical body that would be known as Atum Ra. And by that time, Geb, called Earth, was thriving with life. And he walked among them, taking a place among their first civilization and living as their pharaoh. He created other netters or deities, including Hathor, who could spread love or hate depending on her depiction, whether she be Sekhmet, the lion goddess, or she was Hathor, the cow goddess. And for a time, Atum ruled as the first pharaoh of the people. But he knew that the time of his physical body was limited, and he set things in place so that Asar would ascend as the ruler of the people of Earth. And when his physical body died, he took his last voyage through the Duat, and again merged with his form of Atum, becoming a disembodied existence that we still call on to this day. But every night, Atum Ra descends into the underworld, and it is there that Apep awaits him, always seeking to bring an end to the order and bring about the time of ultimate chaos. But armed with his pantheon of netters, his powerful grandchildren and children, Atum could descend into the underworld each night, knowing that he was defended and safe against the attacks of his brother Apep. And there is the endless cycle of chaos seeking to destroy order, and order seeking to push the boundaries of creation.